CPU, computers, people, and understanding. The show where we take you, the viewer, through everything you need to know about your home PC. Today's episode, we're going to be showing you printers. We're going to be covering dot matrix, bubble jet, and laser printers. I'm Rob Farr.
And I'm Sean Banky. We're going to be taking you through also the installation of a typical printer on your computer system. We'll be showing you how to hook it up using the parallel cable and actually how to install the drivers through the Windows 95 operating system.
Now, in the beginning, there was what was called the dot matrix printer. We have an example of that right here. Now, the dot matrix printer worked much like a typewriter. What it did, it had a ribbon that went around a head. Now, this head had little pins in it, and as the paper went past the head, the computer would send signals to the printer telling it when to shoot these heads out and hit the ribbon. Now, by the little heads going out and hitting the ribbon, it would actually form the image or the text on the piece of paper. We have here an example of a dot matrix output. Now, the actual output itself, it's what looks much like a typewriter, and we used what was called fanfold paper or tractor feed paper. Now, the tractor feed paper had little holes down each side, and that would go into the printer's tractor feed. Now, the tractor feed on most dot matrix printers was found at the back of the printer, like the example that we have here. Now, this particular one, the tractor feed, are these two rollers at the back. And the little bumps on the tractor feed itself, on the wheels, lined up perfectly with the holes on the tractor feed sides of the paper. Now, this tractor feed would allow very precise paper feed for doing things like graphics and stuff like that. Now, with this particular printer that we have, it was a black and white, and it was also a color printer as well. We'll just take the cover off here and show the inside. Now, this was the actual ribbon right here. Now, in this case, this ribbon is actually a four-color ribbon. And it was a bit wider than most of the ribbons found on the printers at the time. Now, in this case, we had a black, a blue, a red, and a yellow. Now, what the printer would do, it would print one line of a specific color, and then it would move this ribbon either up or down to do the next color. So say if you were printing green, it would first print a layer of yellow, and then it would go over it again, printing a layer of blue. Now, depending on how deep the color was, it would either have to make one pass or multiple passes to get the correct color output. Now, what we also have here, I'll show you quickly, is the actual print head itself. Now, the print head is just a small little electromechanical device. You never wanted to touch it after printing out several pages because this got extremely hot. Now, the pins would actually shoot out and hit the ribbon. The ribbon, of course, would be between the platen, or this round roller here, and the paper. Now, by these little pins shooting out, it would actually leave the image on the paper itself. Now, we have a color output example here from this actual printer. Now, you notice the color isn't all that clear. It isn't all that vibrant. And if you look very closely, you'll actually see little lines throughout the image. Now, that's indicating where one specific pass of the printhead went by. You'll notice here that the blue, you'll see a dark section and then a light section. Now, this was a common problem with most dot matrix printers because the ribbon over time would wear out. When you first got the ribbon, the color would be excellent. The colors would be crisp and clear and very, very vibrant. But as it went on, as you use the ribbon, the colors would become more and more washed out. Well, to get around this problem, what came next was called the bubble jet or the inkjet printer. Now, these were actually two different types of printers. The inkjet printer was the first on the market. And what it would do is actually spray ink out on through small little nozzles in the printer, in the print cartridge itself, out onto the paper. Now, you had to have special paper to absorb that much ink. You had to have what was called a clay-based paper. That would actually have a very fine, white, chalky clay layer on the paper that would absorb the ink fast enough. Otherwise, it would saturate the paper, and you'd have quite a mess on your hands. You'd have a lot of bleeding, and the picture wouldn't look very good. Well, to get around that problem, what happened next was called the bubble jet printer. Now, the bubble jet was actually a new, what it would do was, instead of shooting the ink out in a constant stream, it would heat the ink up. And by heating the ink up in the head, in the print nozzles, it would form a small little bubble. And this bubble would actually come out and just burst onto the paper. Now, of course, these bubbles are actually smaller than a human hair, because when the printers first came out, they would do 300 dpi resolution. Now you have bubble jets that do upwards of 1400 dpi resolution. Now we have an example here of a black and white output from a from a bubble jet printer. Now this was from what was called an Epson Stylus Color 2S printer. And this is a black image, actually a grayscale image, much like a photograph, like a black and white photograph in magazines and newspapers. Now, if we change the cartridge from a black cartridge to a color cartridge, we would actually have a color image. Now, this is the same image that we have here now as the black and white, but instead printed with a color cartridge. And you'll notice there's quite a bit of difference. Even compared to our early dot matrix, the color is consistent all the way from top to bottom. There are no little lines being shown here. That's one of the advantages of using a bubble jet or an inkjet printer. The ink, you'll get constant output, because when the ink runs out of cartridge, the printer will stop and tell you, okay, time to replace the color cartridge because it's out of ink. Now that brings us to the next type of printer you'll find in the home environment, the laser printer. Now the laser printer is actually a takeoff of photocopier technology. It uses, instead of a print cartridge or a drum, or a print, I should say an inkjet cartridge, it actually uses a drum, okay, with what's called toner. Now in this case, this is the actual, in this particular type of printer, this is where the image is formed, okay? A laser printer, a common misnomer about laser printers is that a laser actually burns the image onto the paper. That's not true. What a laser printer does is it puts the image onto a roller, okay? This roller then transfers a static image onto the paper. The paper is then run through another section of the printer where what's called toner, okay, which is very, very fine, almost dust-like particles of printing media, okay, is applied to the paper. Now, wherever there's a static charge, that toner will stick. Where there's not a static charge, it won't stick. Then what happens is the paper with the toner passes through what's called the fuser. Now the fuser actually bonds the toner to the paper. Now we have an output here, example of what a laser output looks like. Now you'll see here, the edges are nice and crisp and clean, and the text is very legible. Now this is I believe a 600 DPI printer. Okay, now DPI stands for dots per inch. And that's one of the major things that you want to look for when you're buying a printer, is what the resolution is capable of. Your bubble jet printers, you're looking at around anywhere from 300 upwards of 1400 DPI. With laser printers, you're looking at around 300 to 600 DPI for most of the home models. Now you can get up higher with higher DPI, but you're going to be paying more money. Now dot matrix printers, even though they're harder to come by, they are still available. Now, those printers, you're looking at around 300 dpi maximum for the resolution.
Now, depending on what you actually want to do with your printer will depend on which model you get. For instance, say you need to do multiple carbon copy printouts. Well, the only printer that is really capable of doing that is the impact printer or the dot matrix. That's really what it's been designed for. A lot of the carbon copy paper does come in the loose, the fan full side with the little hole wings on the side. Those printers will range anywhere between $200 to $400. Now, you can get what's called wide carriage printers as well that handle much bigger sheets of paper. Now, they run a little bit more, usually above $500. Now, the most popular printer in today's home market happens to be the inkjet or bubble jet, depending on which company you deal with. Now, the color one seems to be the largest one in the market, mainly for that reason, color. People like to see color. Now, you used to be able to get the straight black and white, well, it's just a black cartridge, a mono ink cartridge, and that was great for printing out text. Now, as Rob mentioned before, the differences between the inkjet and the laser print, you can get high definition quality off of both, but for a much more sharper detailed one, you want to go to the laser. The inkjet was a little more economical sound for a lot of people who could not afford the lasers, so that's why they went to the mono ones. The mono inkjets you can probably still find for around $200. The color ones, which are a lot more popular, usually range between $250 upwards to $800, depending on what type of resolution you want to get out of it. Now, such companies such as Canon, Epson, and Hewlett-Packard all have different types of printers for individual purposes. Now, for high-end graphic artists, people who need really crisp, detailed color output, you would go to a higher-end inkjet that can do greater resolutions. For instance, there's one particular printer that can do 1400 by 720 dpi color output. Now, this is a very sharp, detailed color output, but in order to do that, you needed special paper. Now, if you were in a more an office environment, you needed like crisp office-style lettering, you would go to the laser printer. Now, laser printer nowadays is pretty well mono. It's usually running about between $500 and $700. Although you can get colored laser printers, they usually run upwards to $7,000 to $10,000. So again, depending on the actual reason that you need your printer, you would pick your appropriate printer. After the break, we'll be showing you how to actually hook up and install a printer to your home PC.
CPU is sponsored by BT Video Productions and Computers, located at 140 Highway Street in Petawawa. Phone 687-5198.
And welcome back. We're going to get right into the installation of this printer. Now, first of all, there are a few things you need before you actually hook the printer up to your computer. First of all, you need a printer cable. Now, a printer cable comes in various lengths, which depending on how far you want your printer away from your computer. Now, the important thing with the printer cable is it's a special cable called a Centronix cable. The reason it's called a Centronix cable is because of the 36-pin Centronix cable connector on the end. Now, what this is this connects actually into the printer. And the other end, which happens to be a standard serial connection, will plug into the back of your computer. Now, the differences between the two is, of course, one won't fit in the other. When I'm hooking this, I'll be hooking this in end up to the back of my computer. Now, you can tell it will only go into one particular slot. In this particular case, we have the serial cable, which is underneath, and the parallel cable, which is up above it. Now, depending on your computer case, these would be located in different areas. Now, the parallel cable is usually a female slot on the back, and it just simply plugs in to the back, and I'm just going to screw this on. Now, when you're putting these onto the back of your computer, make sure your computer system's off, first of all. Now I'm going to simply take the other end, and it's just located, the connector's over here on the side of this particular printer, and it'll simply clip in. Now there's two little tabs on the inside, as you can see here, and I'm just going to flick those down so it locks the cable securely into place. All right, now that I have that, I do have my printer plugged in, so there is power to it. So now that I have that, now it's just a matter of turning on the computer and turning on my printer. Now, depending on the operating system you have, for instance, on this particular system, we're using a Windows 95 operating system, which has a feature called plug and play. Now, depending on the printer, the computer system will automatically detect what type of printer you have and install its own drivers. Now, as I mentioned before in other episodes, Windows 95 does have its own particular sets of drivers. If it does detect this printer, it will come up saying this particular printer has found. In this case, it hasn't. So what I do then is simply use the drivers that do come with the computer, with the printer, that is. Now, note a warning before you actually after you go buy a printer and take it home. Most printers that come packaged together do not include a parallel cable. So you have to be sure that you do buy a parallel cable for your printer, whether it be 6 feet, 10 feet, or whatever. Because if you go home and try to hook up this printer to your computer and find out I'm missing a cable, you'll have to truck all the way back and get one. Now, the way you install this printer using the Windows 95 operating system is quite easy. In your Windows 95 operating system, we're going to go down to our Start button. And we're going to click on here, and we're going to go to Settings. Now, in the Settings, you have your Control Panel, your Printers, and your Taskbar. We're simply going to go to Printers, and it'll open up its own window. Now, as you can see here, we have no printer drivers installed. And what we do have, Add Printer. And what I do when I double-click on that, use my left mouse button, is it'll bring up an Add Printer wizard. And this is simply going to take me step-by-step on how to install my printer drivers. So what I'm going to do is just hit Next. And as I mentioned before, Windows 95 comes with a bunch of its own default drivers from different manufacturers that make printers. I'm going to go down to here because mine happens to be a Canon bubble jet printer. Now, as I mentioned, plug and play, this is where Windows gets its plug and play drivers. If I scroll down, and this one happens to be a Canon bubble jet 4100, and as you can see, it only has the drivers for the 4000. So what I'm going to do is simply put in my first disk of my installation and go down to Have Disk. Now it's going to ask me where is this disk located. I'm going to go to A drive. It's going to read the A drive and continue with the, it's actually going to come up the window first, ask me which driver it wants to install, because this particular one has multiple drivers for the different Canon printers. So first one's the 4100. It's asked me where it's located. I only have one printer port, so I'm going to leave it on the printer port. Hit Next. That's the printer name. And it's asked me, after it's done installing the Windows drivers for this printer, it's going to ask me if I want to print a test page. Well, in this particular case, I don't want to. It is recommended, though. And I go to Finish. So right now, it's going to continue along reading the drivers off the A drive and install it into my Windows 95 operating system.
All right, now while the software is loading, I'm going to tell you a little bit more about your printer cables and the different types that are on the market. Now, most of the printer cables that you'll get today are called bidirectional. Now, the reason why they're bidirectional is, as printers evolved and printers got smarter, okay, the printer itself was able to tell the computer when there was a problem printing. In the early days with dot matrix printers and some of the earlier bubble jets, the printer itself wasn't all that smart, and if there was a problem, say if the ran out of ink or the paper jammed, the computer would still try to send the information to the printer. Now in that case, any data that was sent while the printer was down was lost. Now, in the early days, you had what was called a unidirectional cable, which means information could only flow one way, from the computer to the printer. Well, like I said, as printers got smarter, the printers were able to tell the computer when there was a problem. So what had to be invented was a bidirectional cable, so that information could go from the computer to the printer, but if there was a problem, the printer could signal the computer that there was a problem. Now, a newer advent in printer cables is called the high-speed bidirectional cable. Now, this is for the newer bubble jets. okay? Some of the HPs and Canon printers are able to use a high speed line. Now, what this does is it gets the information from the computer to the printer that much faster. But you have to make sure that A, your computer can handle it, and also your printer can handle it.
Yeah, just about done here, Rob. I'm just on my last disc, my installation. And as I mentioned, most printer drivers will have various numbers of floppy disks or CD-ROMs to install. This one particularly happened to come on 4 floppy disks. The newer printers and the newer installation usually come on the CD-ROM, which come with, again, its own installation wizard. But it also gives you a tutorial on how to troubleshoot your printer, how to tweak the output settings. It also gives you the help files all on the CD. This one is asking me to actually restart my Windows 95 now so it can take advantage of the new printer drivers it has installed. It's just simply asking me to hit OK, so I'm going to do that. And as it's doing that, it will reboot, and the next time I boot up, I will have access to my new inkjet printer.
All right. Now, we've shown you some output from common bubble jet printers. What we have here is an example of one of those higher-end printers, one of the Epson printers. Now, the Epson bubble jet printer that are currently on the market, some of the models are capable of 1400 DPI, or dots per inch resolution. Now, we have a printout example here of the actual an image printed from that printer. Now, in this case, it's very difficult to tell the difference between the original photograph and the actual printed copy. But we'll just peel this plastic back here, and as you can see, the upper picture here is actually the photograph, where the bottom picture is the printout. Now, to get this kind of resolution, you need a special paper. Most printers will come with high resolution paper that you can use to print out the high resolution pictures. A package of this paper will usually run around $15 to $20 depending on the size of the paper. Now, you'll get a small package of this usually with most printers that you buy today.
All right, I've now rebooted my system and I'm ready to test run my new bubble jet printer. So I'm simply going to go to my start button, back to my settings, my printers, and you can see the new Canon BJC41 print driver is there. Now, if you want to actually see what properties are part of this, you can simply move over your cursor over top of the icon, hit your right mouse button, and it will bring down a menu. What we're simply going to do is go down to properties. Now, what this is giving you the general properties of this particular printer. If you go down to details, it'll tell you exactly what parallel port is printed up to, what the driver is. It also gives you different settings for different modes of printing, such as an MS-DOS print or a Windows print. You can also set it up, as Rob mentioned, the different types of paper. Now, this particular one has an orientation where you can print it as a portrait or a landscape, which will print everything out lengthwise. The media type here is, right now, it's set up for plain paper, which basically means your standard photocopy paper or your bond paper. Now, you can get different types. As it has here, it has a different listing of the types of paper that you can use to improve the output quality of your picture or document or whatever you're printing from your word processor desktop publishing program. Now, you have your coated transparency, glossy paper, high glossy film. There are many different types. Also, the next one over, you can set your graphics. Now, this is where, if you want to do a very simple printout without worrying about quality, up to your highest possible setting. You also can print, because this particular cartridge, and most cartridges in the inkjets nowadays come in a dual cartridge, where I have a black cartridge and a color. And the different control settings throughout. This one allows you to actually do a test print to see what your printer output looks like.
Well, that's all the time we have for today's episode. We've shown you the different types of printers, the quality, and how to hook it up. Hopefully this will help you when it comes time for you to buy the printer for your home PC. For CPU, I'm Rob Farr.
And I'm Sean Banky. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks.